بسم الله، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله أستكمل مع حضراتكم اليوم بأمر الله تعالى. شابتر 9 إن شاء الله. إن شاء الله تعالى بإذن الله. إن شاء الله. Let me share the file. I'm going to explain from it. Okay, just I have finished the previous lecture with this hydrogen molecule formation, and this is the potential energy diagram. You could call it potential energy energy profile diagram for the formation of the hydrogen molecule. Just reminding you that we are discussing the formation of covalent bond, and I have mentioned many times the covalent bond is always formed by sharing the electron between two atoms. Okay, and if look for example, if you let this hydrogen atom be close to each other, there are many electrostatic attraction, the repulsion between the same charges, electron-electron, and the nucleus-nucleus, and the attraction between opposite charges, nucleus-electron, nucleus-electron, okay? And so on. Once you are closing the molecules together to form the bond, this could, you could expect that some of overlaps between from two atoms are overlapped together, okay? Overlapped together, okay? Which guarantee the bond formation. In order to get the bond, some area between the two bonds are, it's kind of overlap between these two atoms. Just look to this, okay? To this two separated atom, when you, it's energy in that place. And if you let them close to each other, as I mentioned, there are many electrostatic attraction, okay, the energy decreases once the orbitals begin to overlap. Overlap, it's a common area between both atoms, okay? And going to this direction, the area of overlap increases, or the degree of overlap increases, and the stability reaches its maximum value, okay, at which the bond is formed. Okay, at which the bond is formed, it's called equilibrium bond length, equilibrium bond length, okay? And this area, it's the maximum area of overlap, okay, at which the bond is formed. If you try to let the two atoms become closer and closer, okay, the energy increases again. The energy increases again due to the strong repulsion between the positive nuclei, due to the negative repulsion, or repulsion between the negative, positive nuclei, okay? At this, exactly at the bond length, there is a balance between the electrostatic attraction, which are attraction between the opposite charges, and the repulsion between the same charges. Okay, it's called the potential energy diagram. Potential energy decreases with increasing the overlap, and at that one, balance between attractive and repulsion forces. Okay, and here nucleus repulsion increasingly important because it lets the energy goes up and up and up. Just okay, read with me this kind of things. Okay, just increasing the overlap brings the electron and the nuclei closer together, okay, while simultaneously decreasing the electron-electron repulsion, okay, that's why the energy decreases. However, if atom get too close, more than the internuclear distance, the repulsion increasing, repulsion between positive nuclei greatly rises the energy, okay, and that's that part. Okay, that's part. Okay, that's I have already discussed with you in the previous lecture. Okay, let us go to the what's hybrid orbital. Okay, Actually, we have discussed before the Vesper valence shell electron pair repulsion, which we discussed before, okay, which gives us the electron domain geometry and the molecular geometry and the angle between the angle between the atoms and so on. Actually, Vesper, okay, it cannot explain. Cannot explain the bond formation. Cannot explain the bond formation. Also, it does not give any information about which orbitals are used in the bonding. So we are going to discuss the second theory, which is called valence. Okay, valence bond theory. Okay. From its name, it's mainly depending on the valence electrons, which always used in the bonding and the chemical reaction. And there is no any contribution to the core electrons. Okay, so we are going to deal with the valence electron in the same, okay, in addition to the orbital at which this valence is are found. Okay, before discussing the beryllium difluoride, I like to discuss the formation of methane, and we will be back to that one. Okay, in valence bond theory, okay, we discuss, okay, we will define a new concept which is called hybridization. Okay, hybridization or hybrid orbitals, hybrid orbitals. Okay, be with me. Okay, just reminding you that the sharing of electrons or the covalent bond are formed due sharing of electrons. Keep in mind that these electrons should be single occupied. It should be single occupied orbital. What does it mean? Just I would like to discuss together the carbon tetrachloride or methane. If you look to this compound, you see here the carbon forms four covalent bonds. This is okay, Lewis structure. There are four covalent bonds. What does it mean? It means the carbon share with four electrons. Okay, how this electron comes from? Okay, in order to be a great chemist, okay, and you can explain many things, you should be quite aware with the periodic table and the electronic configuration for any element in the periodic table. Okay, the first place you should write the electronic configuration for carbon. Okay, so 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Okay, p, there are three orbitals. It contains the two unoccupied atomic orbitals, and we are talking about the atomic orbital. Atomic orbitals, it means the orbital on an atom. Okay, keep in mind that we are going through this, okay, through the molecular orbital theory. We discuss about molecular orbital, okay, molecular orbital and okay, atomic orbital. We are discussing now the atomic orbitals. Okay. Okay, just keeping in mind or considering this electron configuration, one could expect the following. Just the carbon will form only two covalent bonds. Why two? Because it has only two singly occupied orbitals. It has two electron unoccupied, just only two, because the covalent bond comes from singly occupied orbital. Okay, in reality, it forms four bonds. So what's happening? What's happening? Something is missing. The first, there are two things exactly. The first one, okay, in order to form four covalent bonds, the carbon should contain four single electrons. And how this happened? This happened by promotion or transferring of one electron from 2s to the saved p orbital. Okay. At the end of the day, carbon should be 6, okay, 1s2, 2s becomes one electron only, and 2p becomes a three single electron, okay, 1, 2, 3. In that case, it can form four covalent bonds. That's great. Okay. Okay, you could expect that from this four bonds, it should be three the same, which came from the 3p orbital, and another one is different, which came from 1s orbital. In reality, we found that the four bonds are equivalent. The four bonds are equivalent, so another something is missing, which is missing is called hybridization. Hybridization. Okay, all of you know what hybridization means. It means mixing. You mix something and you end up with equivalent thing, so to say. Okay, just let me reload it in order to get rid of this writing, and okay, I will continue. Okay, so after promotion, okay, you end up with the electronic configuration the following. Okay, which is that 1s2, 2s1 electron, and 2p3 electron. Okay. Okay, the second step is hybridization, just mixing. You need actually carbon forms four covalent bond. For each bond, you need an orbital. So you should mix the four orbitals. These four orbitals is the one from S and the three from P orbitals. You should mix this four, okay? These four orbitals in order to end up with 1s2, and you end up with four orbitals are the same, and we call them sp3 hybrid orbitals. sp3 means one from S orbital and three from P orbitals. Okay, any one of these four is called sp3. And the energy for these four hybrid orbital higher than the 1s, okay, and the lower than the 2p. That's it. And then if you have these four sp are equivalent, and this is solving the puzzle, which means that the four bonds are equivalent. So each one of this one overlap with the 1s from the carbon, okay, to form the four sigma bonds, which are equivalent. So two things happen here. The first one, promotion, okay, just with a small amount of energy, promotion of an electron from S to P, and second one, hybridization. That's very nice. Let's go to a hybrid orbital for this example, which is beryllium difluoride. As I mentioned, to be a good chemist, to be a good, a great chemist, you should be aware with the electronic configuration with any element in the periodic table. That's nice. Okay. And in the first place, you should write Lewis structure. Lewis structure for beryllium difluoride is that one. Okay. And beryllium is less octet because around it, it's less than 8 electrons. You see here, okay, just we have to write first the electronic configuration for beryllium. Beryllium is, it's a 4 electron, 1s2, 2s2. With this electronic configuration, it shouldn't form any bonds because there is not any single electron. Allah. Okay, so we experimentally beryllium form two bonds. This means two covalent bonds. This means it shared it shares with two electrons. Okay, so bromation should happen. The bromation in the first place should happen, and the electronic configuration for beryllium becomes 1s2, 2s, one electron, and 2p. It contains the three orbital, one electron and one just only, which comes from from this one to the 2p. And now it forms two single two covalent bond. What does it mean? It should contain at least two single electron, okay? And they are this one and this one. One could expect that the bond that comes from B should be different from the bond that comes from overlapping of S with the fluorine. In reality, two bonds, the two bonds are equivalent, are the same. So what does it mean? It means these two orbitals should mix it in the first place, and you end up with that beryllium 1s2. It's a core electron, nothing happened with it, and it should be how many orbitals you mix it, one from S and one from P, so you end up with two orbitals, and they are called SP. It means one from S orbital and one from P, from the P. Okay, and still two unhybridized orbital, the other two, these two, they are 2p, as they were. Okay, and this is two hybrid orbitals, and they are called SP hybrid orbitals, and the type of hybridization for beryllium, it's SP hybridization, and the energy for any of this SP orbital is higher than the 1s and the lower than the 2p. Great. So now these two single occupied contains each one contains one single occupied orbital can overlap with the p orbital from the fluorine to form two bonds exactly the same. Okay, that's what I have mentioned. We will read it, just only will read it now. Okay, consider the beryllium. In its ground state, beryllium would not be able to form any bonds. Why? Because all electrons are occupied. So something should happen. But if beryllium absorbs a small amount of energy, one electron, okay, can be promoted from the 2s to 2p, okay, to end up with this two single occupied orbital. Now it can form bonds, but if in that way it should be the bond that comes from overlapping with B should be different from this one. Okay, in reality both of them are exactly the same. What happening? The happening is the hybridization. Mixing the S and the P orbital yields to degenerate. Okay, can anybody tell me what degenerate mean? I mentioned it many times. Degenerate, it means the same energy. Okay, they are equivalent. Degenerate, you have more than one state, one orbital, one and more than one, anything with the same energy. Okay, more than it's two degenerate orbitals, that which are called hybrid orbitals. Okay. And they are represented by SP, and why SP? Because one from S and one from P orbital have two loops. Okay, the new SP should be, okay, if so be with me, if we have parents, father and the mother, and the got some children, can anybody tell me the character, the feature of the children? It comes from both parents. Okay, mother and father. The same, these hybrid orbitals, the character of SP or hybrid orbital, it's a characters are mixed between the S and the P. Okay, and this is, they have two loops like P, okay, has two loops like the P orbital, and the big loop, okay, the larger loop is more rounded like the S one. okay, C, and if you put them together, okay, it looks like these two hybrid orbital. Okay, SP hybrid orbital short together, and it's, it, which is appearing here the bigger loops, because the smaller one here, for this one, it's covered by the big, the bigger, or the larger one, and also the smaller, the small loop here, it's covered by the larger loop in that one. Now we have two SP hybrid orbital, which they can overlap with S orbital, okay, from both types. I'm sorry, not S, from B orbital, fullerene. Okay, let me reload it. Okay, it's beryllium, as I mentioned, it's beryllium difluoride. The valence electron in fullerene in P orbital. So this one will overlap, okay, with P orbital of the fullerene. And here, okay, this one to give you two sigma bond, this one and this one. Okay, that's great. Be with me. These two degenerate orbitals would align themselves in a straight line in order to decrease the repulsion, and the angle between them is 180. This is consistent with, okay, this is in agreement with the observed geometry of beryllium. I mean, the experimental results that they are linear. And see, these are the two hybrid orbitals, this one and this one, and each one overlap with the B from fullerene to give you this, the sigma bond, this one, and sigma bond, this one. That's great. Okay. And as I mentioned, there is still two unhybrid orbitals, two P vacant with the hybrid. With hybrid orbitals, the orbitals diagram of beryllium looks like, as okay, we have discussed all the figures. These SP orbitals are higher in energy than the 1s and smaller than the 2p, as I mentioned to you. Okay, let me get a bit difficult. We are going to discuss the formation of beryllium, boron trifluoride. Boron trifluoride, if you can, anybody remember the Lewis structure for this one? Is it verified octet rule or less octet or more octet? Can anybody answer me? Hello. As usual, nobody is going to answer me. Boron trifluoride, it looks like this one. And actually, it's less octet, okay, according to the formal charge calculation. And each fluorine, it contains three ampere electrons, okay. And the angle between this one, 120, it's trigonal planar, okay. And if you look to, okay, just I'm going to write the electronic configuration for boron. Boron is 5. 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. According to this electronic configuration, it should form only one covalent bond. أتمنى الناس تكون معايا شباب الله يكرمكم. Okay, be with me. It's chemistry, the most interesting science, overall science, according to my opinion. Okay, it should form only one single bond. In reality, it forms three bonds, as you see. This means we need to have three single electrons. So the first single promotion from one, this one, to that one, in order to get 1s2 to 2s1 and 2p2. Now you have three single electron. As I mentioned, it should be this. These two should be different from the 1s. In reality, the three sigma or three covalent bonds are exactly the same, are equivalent, are degenerate. Okay, something is missing after promotion. The first promotion, I think, comes hybridization. Okay, you should mix these three orbitals, one from S and two from B, to end up with three hybrid orbitals, and they are called SP2, one from S and two from P, and you still have one P unhybridized. These three orbitals have the same like B orbital with a small lobe, and the larger one have this, it's surrounded like the S orbital. Okay, one, this one S, and this is two P orbital. You end up with three, as you see. Okay, the angle between them 120, and if you put them together, you end up with this. Okay, the bigger lobes, because the smaller are covered by the bigger one. Okay, they are called 3SP hybrid orbital. That's great. Okay. And so on. It should, everyone should, it's important, trifle, right? Each orbital are overlap with B from fluorine. Okay. To give you three covalent together. Okay. That's great. This type of hybridization is called SP2. Okay. I'm wondering why you are. You are quite silent. I don't know why. Okay. I hope you be with me. Very bad. That's very bad. Okay. Let's we make these things more difficult. We're going to discuss. I have already discussed with you, just referring with you the methane or carbon tetrachloride. As I mentioned, forms four covalent bonds should contain four electrons, so promotion should happen from one S to the P, and then mix three P orbitals with one S, with one S orbital. So the type of hybridization SP3 means one orbital from the S to S, and three orbital from the 2P to end up with four SP3 hybrid orbitals, and the looks like that one, and they are directed to the corner of the tetrahedron shape, the angle between them 109. Okay, they are called SP3 hybridization, and which they can overlap with S orbital from each hydrogen in order to form the four covalent bonds, okay, and the angle 190.5. That's great. Okay, this is summarize the type of hybridization between different type of orbitals. Okay, for the linear molecule, okay, the center atom form two covalent bonds, so you mix one from S with one from P to give two SP orbitals. The angle should have 180, and you still have two unhybrid orbitals. Okay, it looks like this one. For the trigonal planar, the center atom forms three covalent bonds, so you need three hybrid orbitals. So you should mix one S with two P to end up with three SP2 hybridization, and you still have one unhybridized. The angle here, it's 120. Okay, for the tetrahedral CH4C2C or carbon tetrachloride, each central atom forms four covalent bonds. So you need, or this atom should contain four single electron. So this four single electron should occupy four hybrid orbitals, one from S and the three from P, to end up with four SP3 hybridization, and no P orbital unhybridized. And the angle here, it's okay, 109.5. That's great. Okay, that's very great. Okay, suppose for the octahedral and the trigonal bipyramidal, for example, phosphorus pentachloride or sulfur hexafluoride. Here, for example, the central atom phosphorus form 5 covalent bonds. What does it mean? It means it needs to have 5 single electrons and 5 orbitals. The 5 orbital comes from 1 from S and 3 from B. This form 4. And you need another one to be 5, so you need one from D. And this kind of hybridization starts or found in the third row of the periodic table and the lower rows. Okay? The third row and the lower row, fourth and the fifth and sixth, which contains D orbitals. You end up with 5 orbitals, hybrid orbital sp3d. Okay? And you how many orbitals for the d orbital subshell? There are 5. And you take one and make it hybridized, and still 4 without any hybridization. Okay? For the octahedral, you need 6 single electrons and 6 hybrid orbitals. 1 from s, 3 from p, 2 from D, so called sp3d2 hybridization, and you still have 3d orbital without any hybridization. The structure here is octahedral. The angle is 90, as you know. Okay, for the trigonal pyramidal, the angle is 90 and plus between the equatorial 120 and so on. That's great. I'm really happy. Okay, now, as I mentioned, we are discussing the valence bond theory. So valence bond theory is the main player, or the hybridization is the major player, main player in that theory, which is called the valence bond theory. Hybridization, it means mixing, okay, with different orbitals, and you end up with equivalent orbitals, okay, degenerate orbitals, and so on. As I mentioned, after hybridization, the orbitals overlap together. They overlap together. In reality, in general, there are 2 types of overlapping. 2 types. There are 2 ways for the orbital to overlap. Okay, be with me. It could be, okay, head-to-head overlap or side-to-side overlap. Head-to-head produces sigma bond. And parallel overlap, side-to-side, produces pi bond. Keep in mind that the sigma bond, is more stronger than the pi bond. Okay? Be with me. If you have any diatomic molecules, or not, okay, any 2 atoms bounded or bonded with single bond, okay, directly this bond is sigma. If you have multiple bonds, if it's a 2 or triple bond, for the double bond, the first one is sigma and the second one is pi. For the triple bond, okay, the first one is sigma and the other 2 are pi bonds, okay? We have 2 ways of overlap. The first one is sigma bonds, okay, which comes from head-to-head overlap, and the electron density, okay, it's arranged around the internuclear axis, okay, and this is head-to-head overlap, or side-to-side, or parallel overlap, and the electron density is arranged up and down the internuclear distance. Just read this kind of things with me, as I always do. Just I'm telling in the first place, and then read together what I have explained. Sigma bonds are characterized by the following head-to-head overlap, okay? And also characterized by cylindrical, something like cylinder, okay? Symmetry of electron density about the internuclear axis, okay? Like a cylinder, and the electron density are arranged around the internuclear distance, okay? And the pi bond is characterized, or the pi bonds are characterized by side-to-side overlap and electron density above and below the internuclear axis. Okay, internuclear axis. Okay, as I mentioned, single bond always are sigma. As I mentioned, okay, because sigma overlap, the overlap in the sigma is very stronger than the head-to-head overlap. So at the end of the day, its energy is higher than the energy or more of the pi. That means it's more stable and more stronger than the pi bond, okay? Resulting in a stronger bond and the more energy lowering. Energy lowering, it means it becomes more stable, okay? Just look to this one. It's one bond between any two atoms. It's a sigma bond. If you have multiple bonds, one is sigma, and the other or the rest are pi. If they are double, so one pi. If they are triple, two pi, or one sigma and two pi. Okay, as you see, that's nice. Okay, this is multiple bonds. As I mentioned, multiple bonds, one of the bonds is sigma and the rest are pi bonds, as I mentioned. Okay, let's discuss together that example. It's formaldehyde, HC double bond OH. Okay, formaldehyde. Okay, and look to this central atom, carbon. How many sigma bond it formed? One, two, and the one from this double bond should be three. It means it required three hybrid orbital. So the type of hybridization, one from S and two from B, it's SB2 hybridization. And I could ask you about the electron domain geometry of the carbon. It should be trigonal planar and the angle 120. So you have three SB2 hybridization. Two of them are overlapping with the hydrogen to form two sigma bonds, and the third one overlap with the SB2 from the oxygen, the other oxygen, okay, to give you this sigma. That's very great. And if you write low structure, there is still two electron here, two pairs of electron non-bonding. And by the way, keep in mind that very important fact, which is the non-bonding electrons are required hybrid orbitals. Okay, the non-bonding to be accommodated in orbital should be hybrid orbital. Should be hybrid orbital. Okay, one C oxygen is pi and the other one is sigma. This is sigma, and the pi, which is parallel to parallel or side to side overlap, the electron density around the internuclear axis, as you see. And for the sigma, it's around the internuclear axis. In a molecule like the formaldehyde, as shown, an SP orbital on carbon overlaps, okay, in a sigma fashion or in a sigma manner with the corresponding orbital of the oxygen, okay? The hybrid orbital are overlapped in a sigma fashion with two hydrogen and the third one with oxygen, okay? You still also keep in mind the following effects. I mentioned that the non-bonding pairs require hybrid orbital. Keep in mind that the following effect, which is the pi bonding always come from unhybridized p orbital, okay? The unhybridized p orbital overlap in a pi fashion, which is side to side overlap or parallel overlap, to end up with the pi bond. That's great. Another example, which is acetylene or ethylene. This is acetylene. Okay, to be a good chemist, to be a great chemist, just write the Lewis structure for acetylene, okay, that one, It's a linear molecule. And how many sigma bond the central carbon forms? One, and one from this three should be two. So each central carbon requires two hybrid orbitals, one from S and the second from B, the type of hybridization SP, okay? And you still have two unhybridized p orbital, which are overlapped in a pi fashion with the other carbon, one from here, with this one to form the first pi, and the second pi with this one to form the second pi bond. Okay, see, you have each carbon SP, one here and one in this direction. This overlap with the hydrogen, and that overlap with the same one from the other carbon, and you still have two unhybridized p orbital, which overlap with these two in pi fashion, okay, to end up with two pi bonds. That's great. See, read with me what I'm going to read right now. Okay, in triple bonds, as in acetylene, we require two sp orbitals to form sigma bonds between the carbon, and the two pairs of p orbitals overlap in pi fashion. Okay. In order to form two bonds, just I'm going to write to you to be aware the electronic configuration for the carbon. One s2, it's a core electron, and 2s. We have we promoted one of them to the 2p. You have 3p here. Each one contains single one. You mix these two together, and you still have two without any mixing, without any hybridization, which are overlapped with each other in each carbon to form two pi bonds. Okay, that's great. تعال نتكلم بقى على delocalization of electron, especially delocalization of pi bonds. And we have already discussed in the previous chapter the resonance, and just reminding you the following, just to consider NO3I. Okay, we have discussed that one in details, and we have mentioned that this, in order to represent this molecule using Lewis structure, you have to use three resonating structure or three resonance structure, which are these three. And in that three, you have a double bond, and according to that Lewis, it should be shorter than these two. Okay, but unfortunately, these three bonds are exactly the same and also degenerate. And it could be this double bond instead of here to be here, or it could be in that one. What does it mean? It means these pi bond, it does not localize. Localize, it means fix it, okay, in a certain place. But it's delocalized over the whole atom or the whole compound, okay? And that's great. Just read with me this kind of things, okay? When writing low structure for a species like a nitrate ion, we draw resonance structures in order to reflect the structure of the molecule or ion. So there are three resonating structures or three resonance structures, okay? And as you see, the double bond is delocalized over the whole or the three oxygen, okay? That's great. See? Okay, in reality, as I mentioned, each four atoms in nitrate has a p orbital, okay? Each oxygen, in addition to the nitrogen, contains singly, okay, a cobalt orbital. Okay, just to be, okay, I could ask you about the hybridization for the central in the atom. Okay, how many sigma bonds? 3. So it contains, so it needs one from S and two from P to have three s p two hybridization, and you still have p orbital without any hybridization, which contains single occupy. Okay, so this is nitrogen, and also oxygen is the same. It contains also p orbital, which contains single occupied one. Each p orbital of oxygen can overlap in a pi fashion with the central atom to form a pi bond. So the p orbitals on all three oxygen overlap with the p orbital on the central nitrogen to form the, or to end up with the delocalization of these pi electrons over the whole molecule. Just look to these two figures. This one and that one, the pi bond is localized on these two atoms. Okay? And this is actually not the reality, not the real structure. Okay? So we use this one as one of the resonating structure. But the right structure is that, the, which involves the delocalization of the pi electrons over the whole molecules. And the electron density is up and down the internuclear axis. Okay? That's great. This means, what does it mean? Okay, that this means the pi electrons are not localized, not fixed. Okay, but not fixed between nitrogen and one of oxygen, but rather are delocalized through the whole ion. Okay, the most common example for the organic compound is benzene. Okay, and we have discussed it has two resonating structures, which can be written. Sorry, reload it. Oh, hello. Okay, benzene, it's hexagonal, as I told you before. Okay, I'm going to reply you in a few minutes. This is the first resonance structure. And the second one, it should be... this... sorry, no. Okay. Yeah, right. These two. Okay, this means actually you cannot, it's not right to use one of any of these two structures to depict, okay, to depict or to describe the real molecule of benzene. So you should use both of them, and they are calling resonance structure. Okay, this bond can be transferred here, and this one here, and this one here to end up with this one. This means, okay. First of all, let's discuss the hybridization for this carbon. How many sigma bond? 1, 2, and 3. Should be sp2 hybridization. The type of hybridization for benzene for the carbon is sp2. And you still have p unhybridized, which contains single occupied orbitals. These, so each carbon contains a p orbital, this. And each one contains one single electron. So they can overlap together. Okay. And the energy is delocalized over the whole molecule, which is called, okay, delocalization of pi electrons. Just read with me this kind of things. The organic molecule benzene has 6 sigma bonds and p orbital in each carbon atom, and in reality the pi electron in benzene are not localized but delocalized over the whole molecule. The even distribution, okay, this delocalization makes the benzene very, very stable. The even distribution of pi electrons in benzene makes the molecule very, very, very stable, as you see. Okay, so this is wrong because the pi, it's localized here, and also localized here. The right one is this one, okay? Delocalization. But here, the pi bonds are localized. Okay, thanks God. Alhamdulillah, أنا خلصت الشرطة. راح أحل معكم الثاني سؤال ده وأخذ الغياب بسرعة إن شاء الله. ولو حد عنده أي أسئلة هرد عليه. البنزين, the 3D structure for benzene. The overall shape of molecule is determined by. يا ترى I can determine. Okay, suppose I don't know the answer. Can you describe the shape by atoms? If I give you, for example, S 5 atoms, SH4. Just you can count and you know? No. So this is wrong. Can you know that? Okay, with both the angles? Suppose I am not sure. Can you determine the molecule with the symmetry? Just reminding you that for tetrahedral electron domain, tetrahedral electron domain, you have three structures down it, so you cannot use this one. Can you use electron affinity to know the structure? Okay, we have not discussed that at all. So the right one should be angle. If I give you the angle between say 109, you could say it's a tetrahedral. If I told you 107, it's trigonal pyramidal, like ammonia. If I told you it's 104.5, it's bent like in water, okay? And so on. If the central atom is surrounded by six electrons, six electron domain, it should be octahedral, square planar, but this is the right one, octahedral. The geometry of methane, CH4 is, is this command is linear? No, it's a tetrahedral. Which tetrahedral is this one, the angle 109.5, okay? And the geometry of the phosphorus trichloride, you should, okay, if I don't give you the Lewis, you should write Lewis. Here it's, I'm making the thing is more easier, and I'm giving you the Lewis structure. I'm asking you about the geometry. How many electron domains? There are four. The electron domain geometry should be tetrahedral. But here I'm asking about the molecular geometry. This is like ammonia, trigonal pyramidal. Trigonal pyramidal. This one. See. The geometry of bromine, boron trifluoride, which is less than, I don't know. Just you have to write low structure. I'm making the things easier, more easy, and giving you the lowest structure. And I'm asking about the geometry. Okay, this is T shape. How many electron domain? There are five. Which the electron domain geometry is trigonal bipyramidal. But you have two non-bonding pairs, so you end up with T shaped. That one. Okay, that's nice. The geometry of xenon tetrafluoride. Also, I'm giving the lowest structure. How many electron domains? Six. Two of them are non-bonding, so you end up with a square planar. Okay, square planar, the geometry. Okay, which molecule is polar? Polars, okay, carbon tetrafluoride, or methane, no. Boron trifluoride, tripromide, triiodide, no. The octahedral structure also it's non-polar. The only one is ammonia. Okay, which molecule is non-polar? Non-polars, okay. Carbon dioxide, it contains the polar bonds. It's non-polar because this oxygen pull in this direction, and the other one pull in the other direction. Okay, that's it. So this is the right one. It's non-polar. The hybridization of the oxygen. It's a very good question. I told you that how many sigma bond? Two. And these two non-bonding pairs require hybrid one. So one, two, three, four, it should be four hybrid orbital. SP3. Very, very important question. I told you that the non-bonding require hybrid one. It should be C. Alhamdulillah, Allahumma laka alhamdulillah. I have already finished chapter 9. Inshallah, I'm going to discuss with you next time the new chapter بإذن الله تعالى.